Thank you, Ellen. This is instruction for the GED math test. So just a real quick little history as to why this got created. This is actually a request from one of our programs. They requested some resources for GED math test. A lot of this is about resources, especially at the end, but I also have some little strategies and tips and tricks along the way. The other thing I want to say before we get started is that this covers a wide variety of levels. A lot of these skills that do show up on the GED math test can be taught and should be taught at the lower level. So you might see things that are, you know, might be found at a much, much lower level, but that's on purpose, that's by design. The other thing I want to say is that I am not the absolute expert on math instruction. Honestly, I think you all are. So there will be places throughout that I will ask for other ideas or for other suggestions. Please feel free to put in the chat box any ideas or any strategies that you have used in your instruction. I want this to be really more of a sharing type of presentation where we all can learn from each other. What we're going to cover this afternoon is talking about basic math resources, the most missed questions, quantitative reasoning, talk a little bit about word problems, then the most missed questions for algebraic reasoning, and then I have a couple slides of resources that I want to talk us through. To get us started, just throw out anything. What are some resources for passing the GED test? And just anything. You can just put anything that comes to your mind in the chat box. Math Antics, GED Academy, Stack Vaughn, Khan Academy, My Math Teacher Dad, ah, awesome. GED Flash, Aztec. I'm assuming that means, Alicia, means yourself, which is good. Common Core Sheets, Aztec Study Guides, CASAS Goals, Kaplan, Aztec, Khan Academy. The practice tests, okay, great. PHET, I guess that's how you say it. I have not heard of that one. GED.com. Okay, great. Thank you so much for that input. Here's what I came up with. Textbooks and worksheets, the internet, YouTube, there's lots of YouTube videos that can help with GED math instruction, Google searches, educational websites, educational software programs, and you mentioned a variety of them, manipulatives, calculators, instructors, so you are a resource, and the learner themselves is a resource. They have tremendous background knowledge and life experiences. So we want to think of the learner also as a resource and tap into their life experiences and bring that into the classroom. We're gonna look at some basic math resources. And again, some of these start at a very basic level. Number line. Number line is great even at a higher level. Sometimes we think of it only at a really basic level, but it can even be really instrumental in teaching algebra, such as positive and negative numbers. When I taught in the program, we used to use things like poker chips, playing cards, flashcards. I want to say something about flashcards. I'm an advocate of students making their own flashcards. I have often wondered if it's the flashcard themselves or if it's the physical writing of that information on a flashcard that actually makes a greater impact in imprinting on their memory. I had a student who I saw her writing in her notebook, and she is writing word for word everything out of her algebra book. And I went up to her and I said, you know, your algebra book is for your use. You can take it. It's yours. You can do whatever you want with it. And she said, no, I have to do this. I have to write out everything. It's the only way that I can learn it. That's the only way that I'm going to remember it. So sometimes I wonder if actually writing out complementary angles, and then on the other side, writing out that definition, if just the physical activity of writing makes the difference. Not to say that then using those flashcards to test yourself doesn't also have an effect, but just putting that out there. Post-it notes can be used for a whole bunch of different things. You know, using them to teach area, using them for even addition, subtraction. I'm going to go a little off on a tangent here with post-it notes. The way post-it notes can also be used is for learners to put down words of affirmation. And what I mean by that is putting down things like, I can do this. You got this. You can do anything you put your mind to, and put them and have learners put them around their house, put them on the mirror so that they see them first thing in the morning. There is studies that have been done that suggest that even if you don't believe those words up front, just looking at those and reading them on a daily basis can actually rewire your thinking and your attitude about yourself and about your abilities. So I'm just going to throw that as another use for post-it notes. That's not quite how we might think of using post-it notes. Students can also use objects around their home and graph paper. We're going to talk a little bit more about graph paper in a minute, and algebra tiles. I personally am not a real fan of algebra tiles, but I have seen some teachers use them very effectively. So if you're one of those that can use them effectively, kudos to you. Just quick, I want to put in the chat box again, any other manipulatives that teachers have used. I know that is not an exhaustive list, and I did not mean it to be. So anything that you want to put in the chat box. Playing cards, yeah, for me, media mode, math apps, dice, absolutely, especially for probability, yeah. Battleship, oh, that's interesting, okay. Coins, absolutely, especially if you're teaching money. Measuring cups, spoons, oh, yep. Spinners. Candy, oh, yes, candy. Here's my old. That was easy, but when teaching beginning algebra, teachers love slapping the button and hearing those words when they have an aha moment when solving problems. That's great. Yes, battleship coordinates. Oh, that's wonderful. Okay, that's how you use battleship. I like that. That's really interesting. Okay, I know I might have skipped a few. Menus for percentages. Yes, exactly. Any of that real life materials makes a difference. Okay, I'm going to move on. So thank you so much for your input. I really appreciate that. Whoops, I think I skipped one. Oops, I did. Oh, shoot. Sorry about that. So we're going to talk about quantitative reasoning. Here are the most missed questions in the quantitative reasoning section. Area and circumference of circle, area and perimeter of polygons, area and perimeter of composite shapes, scale figures, which is just proportions, and then two-step real-life word problems, which talks about interest, discounts, percent, markup, and markdown. I'm going to show you just a few little tips and tricks that might help for when working on these specific skills. One of the things that I found is probably one of the most complicated parts of the geometry is dealing with circles. So here are just a few ideas. So for circumference, an idea that you can use, I like to get students moving and doing something. When they're doing something, they now have a connection to that movement and that action with that particular skill. So one thing you could do is have students take a can, and I like cans because they have a flat top. So it makes it easy for them to measure the diameter. Have them take a can, they can measure the diameter, use that to put into the formula for circumference of a circle, calculate that, then take a string or a measuring tape and actually measure around the circumference of the can to check their answer. Just doing that, the actual measuring around the can, having connected it to doing the circumference formula, pieces those two things together. Here's an idea that I came up with for area. I'm going to be honest, I've never used this. I just came up with this. One of the things that can be a little challenging for students when you're talking about area and talking about circle is we hammer home to them, area means square units, square inches, square feet, square miles. And now all of a sudden you're talking about square units in a circle. And as it goes, you know, trying to put a round circle in a square hole or something like that, or a square peg in a circle. Anyway, so here's what I came up with. And you probably want to teach area of a square and a rectangle first before you do this. So here's what I did. I drew a circle on a graph paper. I know this isn't perfect, but I spent an insane amount of time trying to get these lines right. So if you look here, we have a purple square in the middle. So let's start with that. That is 8x8. So over here, I put down full squares, 8x8. That's that large square in the middle. Then to the sides, I have these rectangles that are still full squares, and they are 6x1, and I have 4 of them, one on each side. So I write down 6 × 1 × 4, I get 24. Then if I go a little bit further out on the circle, I also have these other rectangles that are pretty much full squares, and they are 4x1. So they're 4 going down on the sides by 1 across. And I have 4 of them for each side outside of the main square. So I have 4 × 1 × 4 gives me 16. Then I have basically these half circles. And there are 4 of them on each of the 4 points of that circle. So I'm going to put down 1/2 × 4 × 4 gives me 8. When I add all that together, I get 112. When I put it into the formula based on my radius being 6, I get 113 4/100. So they can see what it means to have squares in a circle and how that works out to come up with the area. I wouldn't have them do this more than once or twice. It's again, just to cement the idea of squares in a circle and how that translates to an area. More graph paper, because I love graph paper. Again, using graph paper, here's the composite shape. Show them, here's my purple dotted line. So I'm going to make one square and one rectangle, or they can use a red dotted line and have a different rectangle and another square on the side. It's good to show them that there's more than one way to divide it up in case they really get stuck. It's nice to have options. Another thing to do is to have learners actually draw a room in their home on graph paper that is a composite shape. A lot of rooms in our homes are composite shapes. Kitchens have countertops or have, you know, something else that's going to break up that room. Bedrooms have closets that then make it a composite shape. Again, the whole idea is for them to have some connection to something that is theirs and relate it to these skills that are commonly missed on the GED test. Common core sheets. I have to tell you, I love common core sheets. I think that was one of the greatest things ever, you know, put up on the internet for math. They have so many different areas. And what I really like about it is that they also have the answer sheet. I know some instructors don't like giving out the answers to students. I almost always gave my students the answers for homework. And the reason I did that was because I wanted them to be able to check their answers at home when they would have time to go back and figure out what they did wrong. Instead of bringing it in and having it done wrong, I wanted them to be able to go through that process on their own. If they still can't get it right, then bring it in and we can discuss it. Some students really kind of balk at that, but then I suggest, well, you know what? Have a supportive member in your household check your answers for you. I say supportive because you don't want to have somebody who's going to, you know, say, oh my gosh, you know, you're not very smart. You want to have somebody who's going to be encouraging. So I give them the answers. Okay. Similar figures. This really comes down to proportions. And this is that infamous shadow problem where you have somebody, they know how tall they are. They know they can measure the length of the shadow. You can measure the length of the barn. How tall is the barn? First, make sure that they label it before they do anything. I see so many learners just start writing down numbers without labeling things ahead of time. Just set it up first. But have students create their own word problems using height and shadows of themselves. So bring in, and I realize this really just kind of works for in person, but they can do it themselves also, even in their own home. If they have a floor lamp, have a floor lamp on, have the rest of the room dark, where they can maybe get somebody again in their household that will measure their shadow. Have a box, measure the shadow of the box, then calculate to see how tall the box is. Then they can go back and they can actually measure the height of the box so that they can see if they're correct. Now I'm gonna say, stop right here for a second and say one thing about these activities. There are some instructors that will balk at this and will say, oh my gosh, this takes too much time. This isn't really helpful. It's helpful because they now have a connection to this. They've done something. It is making an imprint on their memory. What wastes time is doing worksheet after worksheet after worksheet, and it's still not making any connection to their life. So there's a place for worksheets. I'm not saying that there isn't, but my opinion is that getting students involved will have a greater impression and will make a bigger difference on their learning than just doing one worksheet after another. Two-step real life word problems. Again, use real life scenarios, interest, discounts, percents, markups, markdown, using credit cards. looking at a bank statement, shopping during an in-store sale, you know, back in the good old days before the pandemic, or even better yet, using discount codes for online shopping, figuring out their taxes, how much tax they're going to pay, figuring out shipping and handling on an online purchase. Doing anything that connects to their everyday life. I'm going to talk briefly about word problems because there's a different school of thought. I attended a conference about a year ago, and I found out that in the K-12 system, they no longer teach keywords for word problems. That's a thing of the past. And the reason for that is that it relies on memorization of certain words. A keyword is useful and appropriately only within the right context. They really need to understand the concept. Ask themselves, what's going on in this word problem? What's happening? So I'm going to give you an example. I created this word problem and I did this intentionally. Here's my example. Altogether, Randy, Debbie, and Mike have a total of 8 apples. How many apples did Randy, Debbie, and Mike have after giving 3 apples to Tom and Jess? So I color-coded this. Altogether and are addition. Total can mean addition or multiplication, which is why I made total half green and half blue. Blue is for multiplication. We have the word of right after the word total. I have never seen giving to on a list of keywords for subtraction. Therefore, students may focus on the first keyword of altogether and the word total and totally miss that this is a subtraction. I realize this is a very simplified problem, but I'm just doing this to illustrate the point. I have had learners that just zero in on a word and will come back and say, well, but Ms. Ramona, you said to look at the keywords, and this is a keyword. And they're right. It is a keyword, but it's not in the right context. Therefore, they don't always look at the context of what's going on in the word problem. So what they're doing in the K-12 system is they're doing away with keywords and they're working on the context. How do we do that? Well, we can have them draw a picture. Can have them make a chart. There are some word problems that work very well with creating a chart. Have them act it out. I know that sounds silly, but have them act it out. They can even, you know, create a little play. Use manipulatives, use color. And I have to say, this is probably one of my favorites, is have learners write their own word problems. Nothing will cement in a learner what goes into a word problem as much as them writing their own word problems. I've had students do this as a homework assignment. Don't have them write 10 word problems. Have them write, you know, 2 word problems and bring it in and then share with the class. I've also made this into a friendly competition where I break the class into 2 groups and they work together to create word problems. The idea is you don't want to have the word problem so complicated that the other group can't figure it out because it's just that complex. But at the same time, you want it to be complex enough that they have to kind of really think about it and figure out what's going on. I will tell you from experience, learners will create their own word problems much more difficult and complicated than anything they will ever find in a math book. There are some that will come up with word problems that have characters, they have a setting, they have a plot, they have a theme. I mean, they just really take it to a whole nother level. Nothing wrong with that, because then you can kind of get a little writing in there too, which is not such a bad thing. Yeah, give students a scenario and have them make up a word problem from a reading. Exactly, yes. It's a nice way to bring the two together and to get a little bit more mileage out of your lesson. Okay. Any other suggestions for, you know, doing area and perimeter or similar figures or two-step problems? Yep, have students create a chart and then create a word problem from it. I like that, that's good. Anything else that you have done out there? Will you make your slides available? Yes, these will be available when the presentations are archived and made available on a website. The PowerPoint will also be made available. Anything else I know you guys are creative. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and move on. Okay. So now we're to algebraic reasoning. And this is always the one that's a little bit tougher. Here are the most missed questions. Graphing points on a coordinate plane, graphing linear equations, slope of a line. All those have to do with graphing, solving one-step equations, the dreaded quadratic equation, word to symbol translations, and then also solving for linear equations when the solution is given. I did some research on this, and I'm going to be honest. There are some of these that just don't really lend themselves real well to everyday application. Let's start with graphing, since the first three have to do with graphing. Graph paper, coordinate points, and as somebody mentioned, battleship. I love that. That's a great idea. Bringing in a game, making it fun, and yet they can see that whole coordinate point. Maps are coordinate points. Even if you're talking about a large square, it's still having to go down, you know, this, you know, letter D over on number 7 to get to where that city can be found. Linear equations, that's really about relationships. So I have this many girls in my class. I have this many total students. I have twice as many boys. How many students do I have in my class? It also talks about rates, budgeting. So talking about things like unit pricing, which is a great skill for our students because it can be really pretty daunting for them to go into a store and to figure out what's the better buy. And you know, who doesn't want a better buy? Slip of a line. So talking about ramp and incline, you know, can even be talking about things like stairs. You know, we don't want to have stairs like this. That would be a little dangerous. So figuring out what would be a good incline and also talking about rate of change. So again, graph paper, you can find graph paper on the internet. And I would highly recommend, you know, graph paper isn't that expensive, but if you can get your program to buy graph paper, even better. In case we have any administrators on the call, on this presentation. So equations, solving one-step equations. Many of the word problems are one-step equations. It's again, just a matter of getting them used to word problems and thinking through what's going on. The best I can do for a quadratic equation is practice, practice, practice. Here's my two cents about the quadratic equation. I did a search for finding real everyday use for the quadratic equation. I just didn't really find anything. The quadratic equation can be very difficult, not just for students, but also for even for some instructors. pick your battles. If you are really struggling and the students are really struggling, make a decision as to whether that's the best use of your time. I'm not saying don't teach it. Absolutely teach it. I'm not saying it's not important. Yes, they should know it. But it may not be, and at least initially, the best use of your time. Sometimes what you need to do is you need to introduce it, work on it, let it go, move on to something else, and then come back. Sometimes it really needs to sort of percolate in their brain a little bit for it to then make sense. So just, you know, again, put your time where it's best spent. Solving linear equations when the solution is given. Again, this is just, it's practice with word problems. And symbol to word to symbol translation. Again, more practice with word problems. Let me come back to keywords for a minute with this. Yes, there are some keywords. And I'm not saying that keywords are never helpful. Sometimes they are. The problem with relying exclusively on keywords is some learners can really get hung up on it and they just lock onto those keywords for dear life and do not let them go and can't see the bigger picture past those, you know, one or two words. Thank you, Linda. I'm glad you agree about the quadratic equations. Appreciate that. So any other suggestions about the algebraic thinking, about the algebraic reasoning? Like I said, it's definitely the slightly more challenging. It's a little bit harder to bring real life, but it doesn't mean that it's impossible. You can still make word problems that are real life, that are based on, you know, everyday activities, even then. Let's see what we have here. Math is fun. Oh, okay. Oh, I like that. Great. Thank you, Terry. Use interactive graphing tools like that from Desmos. Yeah, they do have interactive graphing tools and they're nice to use. Math goodies and math is fun are great sites as well. Great, thank you. I appreciate that. Virtual graph paper has it. Yeah, it's wonderful the resources that have popped up. The interactive graph tools. Great. Really appreciate these suggestions. Like I said, I'm certainly not the absolute expert on this. I know there's lots of expertise out there in the field. Okay. All right. Thank you so much for your suggestions. I'm going to go through some resources now that I pulled together. The first one is a pretty lengthy document. Let me explain this first. Is anything that is specifically really geared towards the GED test, I put in red. Everything else is just math stuff. So this is first one is a pretty lengthy document. It's just kind of a random mishmash of a whole bunch of math skills that you might not, you're probably not going to use the whole thing, but you might be able to pick out a few things here and there that might be valuable. I attended a learning disabilities conference, and this is one of the ones that came up. It's not available just yet, but they did mention this, that they are working on it. And I thought, wow, this is great. Adult math in real life video series. Perfect. So I included here for when it's available. I'm going to tell you right now, this is not a typo. In the UK, they call it maths with an S. They don't call it math. So that is what they call it. They call it maths for adults. I came across this one and just thought this might be another resource, since we don't typically look at, you know, things outside of the United States. Here's a, not a, it's not a, official practice or even a semi-official practice test, but it does have math questions. I put down Common Core sheets because I love Common Core sheets. Here's the crosswalk for the GED test and the CCRS alignment. I know there are some programs that really stress the CCRS and like to see that, that on their lesson plans. So I include it here for those who want that resource. Yes, math. I know. Don't you love it? It's great. Ed Helper, I have to tell you, when I worked at Learning is for Tomorrow, we used Ed Helper a lot. And I'll tell you, it was invaluable. It is a tremendous resource. Yes, it's $40 a year. I will say I used something from Ed Helper almost every single class that I taught. It just has a vast range of topics and levels. They do have some free material, but it's not that much. So I'm not paid by Ed Helper, so I don't get anything. I don't get anything from it. But just putting that out there as a really good resource. Effortless Math, again, some practice. This was put out by Florida, the Florida Institute for Professional Development, and that includes the slides for the challenging math questions. But I just, again, just a resource. I included GED Academy. I saw that some mentioned GED Academy when we were talking about the resources. And here's just another one that has some math lessons. Again, some more practice. Check out the worksheets that accompany Math Antics videos, $10 per year, 500 worksheets available to share with students. Great, thank you, Carol. Okay, so another resource there. And somebody else did mention a couple, I think, mentioned math antics. Here are some YouTube videos that take you through some practice questions. They're not actual GED practice questions, but they are the skills that are needed for the GED test. And they do take you step-by-step explaining how to work those out. Now we all know that they could say the exact same thing that we say, but somehow by magic, just hearing it come out of a different mouth, looking at a different face can make a difference. So it's, again, just a resource for those who want to use it for your learners. The bottom one here actually takes you through explaining the practice test. I will tell you the sound quality is not the best, but I want to include it because I think it is, it's unfortunate, but it is a good resource. Then we have more practice tests. Here's the important questions on the GED. I included from the GED testing service, the marketplace. They put together a bunch of publications for GED tests. If you're going to look at anything, I would recommend you look at the ones that have this little symbol here that say content aligned. Those are the publications that are, you could say, sort of vetted by the GED testing service that most align with the GED test. So the Florida one can also be used as an app on their phones. Use Khan Academy videos. Okay, great, thank you. Can you please show the first resource slide again? I can go back at the end, but let me get through this. And again, you'll have access to all this information, but let me just keep going and then I can go back. Here we have the practice test. IXL, I know many instructors use that. It has, again, a wide variety of math resources, Khan Academy, most people know this. I really want to put in a plug for Literacy Minnesota. They do a phenomenal job with their professional development. And this link here has an incredible amount of lessons, very professionally put together, and videos to help with explaining those skills. And the last one also, Math Help. Here is a list of a bunch of YouTube videos that go through and explain the most missed math questions. First six are for the quantitative reasoning, and the last three are for the algebraic reasoning. Hi, Pam. We also have Math Worksheet for Kids. I found this also from a conference that I attended. Don't let the four kids stop you. It is $25 a year, but they go all the way up through through high school. So it has definitely the skills that they need. Another one, this is put out by the GED. I'm sorry, by the organization that would be comparable to our GED over in the UK. Again, just another resource. And then online math learning, and then school yourself. So by request, somebody wanted to, And for some reason, it is not letting me go back. I'm sorry. Not letting me go back. I'm trying to hit the back and it's not doing anything. So you'll have to wait till this gets archived. I'm sorry. So the last thing I want to say is, I gave you a whole bunch of resources, but here's my take on instruction and just adult literacy. This is what I think is the best resource of all. It's the connection between you and your students. And that includes empathy, kindness, patience, active listening, compassion, caring, understanding, and modeling appropriate behavior. It's not an all-inclusive list, but my take on this is you can, in theory, have the best strategies, have the best materials, the best resources, but if you're not connecting with your students, a lot of that is going to get lost. Get to know your students and let them get to know you. Build a connection with them, build a rapport with them. It will make all the difference in the world. So I'm going to leave you with a quote. The teacher's primary task is to structure or order the environment for the pupil, in such a way that work is accomplished, play is learned, love is felt, and fun is enjoyed by the student and the teacher. When I was an instructional specialist, I used to tell my teachers, if you're not having fun, I can guarantee neither are your learners. Have fun. Make it fun. It's okay to be silly every once in a while. Every day can't be Disneyland, but you can still have fun. And I think, unfortunately, too often, we make math this very rigid, very structured kind of subject, and it doesn't have to be that way. If you're having fun, chances are, so are your learners. You know, let them laugh. That's all I have. I want to give you my contact information. The easiest way to reach me is email. For those of you who know me well, you know that I love math and I will talk about math any day, anytime. So if you have any questions about this, I am more than happy to entertain, you know, your thoughts, your questions, your comments, anything. So does anybody have any questions at all? I'm happy to answer them. Well, you're welcome, everybody. It was a pleasure to do this. This really is for the person who asked, do you present to ABE programs? Send me an email. So I don't see any questions. So I am going to turn it back over to Ellen.
All right.